Appreciate those on the platform. Amen. You have your Bibles tonight, and I know you do. Revelation chapter 3, the book of Revelation chapter 3. I'm going to talk about rewriting history. Talk about forgetting history. I want to talk about having a momentary lapse of history that we often fail to learn the lessons of history. Our own and others. Revelation 3, 17 through 22. We're going to get there in a moment. A student who auctioned off her virginity on eBay to pay for a master's degree in family and marriage therapy. She's auctioning off her virginity on eBay to pay for a master's degree in family and marriage therapy, and the bidding has hit, I want you to pay attention, the bidding has hit $3.7 million. And to think some of you gave it away for free. Can I just say that out loud? Natalie Dillon, 22 years old, claims her offer of a one-night stand has persuaded 10,000 men to bid for sex with her. At the beginning of all this, when her auction came to light, she had received bids up to $243,000. But since then, interest in her has skyrocketed. The student who has a degree in women's studies insisted she's not demeaning herself. Miss Dillon from San Diego, California, said she was persuaded to offer herself to the highest bidder after her sister, Avia, a year older, paid for her own degree after working just 3 weeks as a prostitute. Oh, great examples for older sisters. 3 weeks as a prostitute, she paid off her college. My study, Miss Dillon says, my study is completely authentic in that I truly am auctioning my virginity. But I'm not being sold into this. I'm not being taken advantage of in any way, she added. It's shocking that men will pay so much for someone's virginity, which isn't even prized so highly anymore. My commentary? No, Natalie, it's not a matter of value, but respect. Respect for yourself and placing your own value on that commodity of virginity. It is obviously no longer prized, Natalie, by you, but judging by the bidding of $3.7 million, I'd say it is still prized by others. Mark Twain once said, the worst kind of loneliness is to not be comfortable with yourself. Revelation chapter 3, verse 17 through 22. The word of God says, because you say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and open the door, I will come into him. I will dine with him and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Did you know that it is possible to be wretched, which is pitiful, to be miserable, poor, and not even know it. Did you know you can be pitiful, miserable, poor, blind, and naked and not even know it? To be those things and refuse to accept the truth about yourself. And worse than that, not only do you not accept the truth that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked, but at the same time, you think you're rich in relative terms. And you think you have need of nothing. Is it possible to be wretched and believe that you have need of nothing? How does that happen? How does that happen that people are wretched, poor, blind, miserable, naked, and they think they have need of nothing? They think they're doing just fine. Somewhere there's a disconnect in their brain. They are absolutely miserable. And they don't know. They think they have need of nothing. I'm reminded of the rich young ruler that comes up and has the has the ability to tell Jesus what he thinks he needs. Because when Jesus tells him, he says, I don't know what to do that, and he walks away. Because he's got it all. So how is it possible? How is it possible? How does that happen? How does that take place that we forget so much about where we came from, who we are, and what we're capable of as individuals? That somehow we have spiritualized our entire lives and we forgot about what we were and how easy, really, our flesh would be to get back there. Because you and I know we've seen it. We've seen it. I mean, it's funny, Felicia said to me tonight as I walked in, she goes, well, I'm here. It's like this is a good move forward. This is, I'm here. I actually came again. And she's been coming on a regular basis. Amen. Praise God, and it's powerful. But she understands. She says that to me because she understands her proclivity to not make it. She understands how many times that she's blubbered. She understands that her being here is just a miracle. Come on, somebody. How do we get to that place where we forget the condition? I want to talk about rewriting our own history. It's important that we finally accept the truth about ourselves, that the only good thing in us is Jesus, that you are not becoming great, but God is raising up a greatness in a transcendent manner. God is raising up this. God is causing this to happen. You can fall right back so fast into what you were, and there is a dialogue and an analogy and a testimony all rolled up right here in this building of people that said, I will not fall. I've got a hold of this, only to fall and miserably dive down that rabbit hole and be miserable, blind, naked, pitiful. We need to finally accept the truth about ourselves. America, church, is a backslidden nation. In its backsliding, it is attempting to rewrite its own history, slandering the founding fathers, misquoting or refusing to include historical quotes about God and being a Christian nation, refusing to believe that America was founded on Christianity. There's a recent example in Fresno. There was a terror attack in Fresno, California, I think just 2 days ago, that killed 3 people. Fresno, this is the Associated Press reporting. Are you hearing me? Fresno Police Chief Jerry Dyer says the suspect in a shooting that killed 3 people in downtown Fresno shouted, God is great, in Arabic, and had posted on social media that he dislikes white people. That's the Associated Press reporting. But nobody said God is great. The police chief didn't say God is great. Not the terrorist didn't say God is great. What the terrorist did say was Allahu Akbar. It means in English God is great, but it has so much more relevance to what actually happened when you quote it properly, when you report the Arabic phrase in Arabic shouted, Allahu Akbar. That strikes far more fear, and that's so much more true about the event that took place. And it planes and it pits it flat on the shoulders of a terrorist, as opposed to report it to a bunch of completely ignorant Americans. And he said, God is great. Because that's something a Christian would say. God is great. So what are they doing? They're putting all God in the same basket. Let me go on. That's like reporting this. Four students stopped at Taco Bell and had little donkeys. Yeah, because the Spanish word burrito literally means little donkeys in English. So instead of reporting it as Spanish burrito, we say, oh yeah, four people entered Taco Bell and bought some little donkeys. See, it completely loses its cultural relevance when you take away the actual term in the native language for what it is. Am I right? Mm-hmm. Of course I'm right. Mexicans cooking little donkeys for dinner does not have the same impact as using the correct Spanish term, burrito. Compare these tweets. The Associated Press tweeted Cindy Stockett. The Associated Press tweeted, Fresno police say suspect in triple slaying told them he hates white people, shouted God is great before killings. That was their tweet for Associated Press. Fox News, however, who is not tweeted on the same incident without the politically correct revisionism, tweeted this, breaking news, Fresno shooting spree, three killed by man who yelled at Allahu Akbar, made Facebook post against white people, police say. So as soon as you read the Fox News tweet, you knew it was terrorism. Not little donkeys. See, America is refusing to face the truth about itself. That it has left its first love and forsaken the God that made her great. It's God that made America great. As America rewrites its history to somehow cope with its present state, that's the problem. It's trying to cope with its present chaos. Have you seen what's going out? What's going on in the big cities in America? Have you seen the protests? Have you seen a group called Antifa? Which is a terrorist, a domestic terrorist group that wears black masks and black hoods and attacks Trump supporters in the cities. America's refusing to face the truth about itself, and it's rewriting history to somehow cope with its present state. The nation falls deeper and deeper into sin. The world no longer respects America. Those responsible for her backslidden state no longer respects her. And with the lack of respect for God and for itself, it no longer matters whether the nation maintains the integrity of its heritage and soon will become a victim of its own bad decisions, a victim of its own poor self-governing and underestimating the true evil around it. In the same manner, if we fail to recognize the truth about our own lives, the truth that we are miserable, poor, wretched, and naked, and in desperate need of a Savior, then we begin to lose respect for the truth and respect for God that is the author of everything good in our lives. We start to think that anything good, we actually have something to do with it. We start to think that we can make this happen. We start to get confidence that we can be good outside of God. We start to think we can walk away from church. Who needs to be here three times a week? Come on, that's crazy. That's fanatical. I can be here once a week. I can come once every couple of weeks. Hey, I got this down. I'll never go back to what I was. That's because you failed to be here Sunday night and hear my Sunday night message. I'm sweeping that house clean but not filling it up. Come on, somebody. We fail to recognize the truth about our lives. We lose respect for the truth. We lose respect for ourselves. We lose respect for our families who love us and for God who has the power to save us. Amen. How many know that as you are truly backsliding into the flesh, all of the things that you begin to do is, number one thing you begin to do is start ignoring your pastor. That's the first thing you do. You stay away from me. See, you might even come into church, but for some reason in a church that only has 33 people or 35 people in it tonight, you'll find a way to miss me. Secondly, you'll miss services. Thirdly, you'll stop taking advice and stop talking to people that are giving advice, good advice. Stop hanging out with people that are telling you what you're doing is wrong. Come on, somebody. And then you start abusing your family again. It's a paradox, isn't it? Only God has the power to save us.
Yeah, that's right.
Only God has the power to save us. See, the church at Laodicea says that they have need of nothing. How many backsliders, how many people I have talked to that are on their way out the door, and I know they're on their way out the door. I can tell they're on their way out the door. I can feel it. Come on, in my spirit. So I call them aside. I'll ask them, is everything okay? Is everything fine? What's going on? Nothing, Pastor. It's great. No, it's not great. I'm not feeling, I'm feeling some adjectives, but it's not great. Great's not the adjective I'm looking for. Yeah, I feel, how can I help? Nothing, Pastor. It's okay. It's okay. What do you need? Nothing. So you have need of nothing. No, you have need of nothing. See, this is Jesus dealing with the very thing I deal with on a weekly basis. Oh, so you're telling me you have a need of nothing. When in fact, they have nothing and they need everything. What a paradox that is. It is possible to be that blind to the truth about ourselves that we reject the only thing that can help us. It is possible to be that blind about the truth about ourselves that we lose and reject the only thing that can help us. They have lost their respect for themselves. They fail to see the truth. So they've rewritten their own history. They've rewritten their own history to say it's okay, they can make it. They can do this. They thought it through. They know what they're doing. They're in control. They've got a hold of this. Somehow they've rewritten their history because that's never happened before. They never had a hold of it before. Come on. You forget who you are. Look in the mirror. Look in the mirror. Take a good close look. I have a scar right here. It's about this long. It's right here. I'm 55 years old. I got that scar when I was 5. A friend of mine, I'll use that term loosely, threw a rock at me. Hit me in the side of the head. They took me to the doctor, who was our next door neighbor, and he didn't stitch it, he clamped it shut. And so it's got just a straight line in the skin forever. So 50 years that scar has been there. I've got another scar right here. And this is 17 stitches. I got bit by a German shepherd when I was in second grade. I've got another scar on my toe where I walked through a construction site barefoot. I know. I was 7 years old, I think. And I cut my small toe, my pinky toe, nearly off, hanging by the skin. 5 stitches took it all the way around. And so I have those scars, and if you look close enough at a 55-year-old body, you can still see those. Spiritually, it's the same way. If you'll look careful enough, you'll be able to see and recognize scars of your life. Scars that have mattered, that they're embodied in the life of your eyes. You can see them as you look in a mirror. You can feel them in your spirit. You can think about them as you close your eyes at night. There are scars in your spiritual life. Scars, mistakes, choices, things that you did, things you're still ashamed of, things that when you even think of, you give yourself your own chill. It was so awful. Yet at some point in your life, you were in a frame of mind to actually do that. And you're telling me you have need of nothing. They lose respect. Lost respect for themselves. They fail to see the truth. So they've rewritten their own history and in the process, becoming lukewarm and losing the thing they should have valued most, respect for the things of God. Let's talk about the loss of respect for a minute. The word respect means, in definition, to feel or show differential regard for or esteem, to avoid violation of or interference with, for example, respecting the speed limit, to relate or refer to be concerned, to respect somebody's feelings, a feeling of appreciation. Often deferential regard, esteem, respect. Willingness to show consideration or appreciation, respecting somebody's values, respecting what somebody's done for you, respecting how they feel. And so these things, this is what respect means. And we lose that respect. I often do this when I counsel marriages and when I preach marriage seminars. I'll tell them what we did when for a good period of time in our family. And that is, if you went off on me, if you're one of my three kids and you spouted off to me and snapped at me and thought you could talk back to me and you blew respect in the household, I would stop everything. I would send you to your room and you couldn't come out until respect is restored in the home. You can come out of your room when you are willing to say, I'm sorry for disrespecting you. Everything stops. No privileges, no toys, no playing, no going anywhere, no doing anything. Everything ceases. The moment you disrespect me, you lose all privileges, 100%. And you don't get one back until you restore respect in the household. That's how you raise kids. It's important that respect remain in the home. It's important that your children respect you. It's important. My son is huge. He's much bigger than me. He's much stronger than I am. The only reason I'm still alive is because he respects me. Because he could have his way with me if he really wanted to. If he was that kid that was, seriously, if he was that kid running around doing drugs, if he was that kid trying to steal money from me, if he was that kid trying to do his own thing, if he was that kid trying to make it happen in his household that he does whatever he wants, and I'm trying to toe the line and pull it, rein him in, I'm telling you, it could be dangerous. I could not be alive. If I didn't have a gun, I'd say. But I do. Okay, so. Amen. When you lose respect for God, I challenge you that you don't even know it's happening. When you lose respect for God, you're not even aware in the beginning that you've lost respect for God. Romans 1 says that they exchanged the truth of God for a lie. They worshiped and served the creature rather than the creator. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions. They received in themselves, in their bodies, in their minds, and in their lives, they received the penalty of their error, which was due them. Verse 28, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind. To do those things which are not fitting. They lost respect for God. They lost respect for Him as a creator. They lost respect for Him as their God. They lost respect for Him as the sovereign of the universe. And they began to lift themselves up like the devil did, like Lucifer did in the beginning. I will exalt myself above you. When you lose respect for yourself and others, Lamentations 1, verse 1 through 9 is a synopsis of the downfall of a once prosperous and functional nation with a bright future. It's a nation that forgot the God who brought them to that level. Come on, does that sound like America? It's talking about Israel, but it sounds like America that we have forgotten about the God that brought us to this level. And the nation was now, Israel was now in bondage in Babylon. And Jeremiah writes stirring prose about their downfall. Judah has gone into captivity, under affliction and hard servitude. She dwells among the nations. She finds no rest. And from the daughter of Zion, all her splendor has departed. With no one to help her, the adversaries saw her and mocked her at her downfall. She has sinned gravely. Therefore, she's become vile. All who honored her despise her because they've seen her nakedness. Her uncleanness is in her skirts. She did not consider her destiny. Therefore, her collapse was awesome. The definition meaning beyond description, beyond the ability and language to describe how bad the downfall was. It was awesome. She had no comforter. And I quote, "O Lord, behold my affliction, for the enemy is exalted." Lamentations 1:9 in Adam Clark's commentary says, "Although evident marks of Israel's pollution and downfall appeared all around her, and the land was defiled by her sinfulness, even to its outermost borders, she had no thought, she had no consideration of what must be the consequence of all of this in the end." That is a picture of you and I. That is a picture of our contemplation of sin. That is a picture of our disregard for destiny, of our taking for granted our walk with God, the church that we sit in. I promise you, if this church closed up tomorrow and you came here and there was an empty building and it was locked up and there was no more Potter's House in this town and the sign was removed or desecrated or taken down and there was graffiti put on the walls of this building, I promise you, you would miss it. You would regret, you would resent the fact that maybe the last couple of months that it was open, you never came. You didn't make it your priority. You didn't honor it as a presence in the community that was necessary. You didn't love the fact that we were even here. That's what happens when we lose self-respect. That's what happens in analogies, what happens in here when we lose respect for ourselves, when nothing matters anymore, when we're no longer the children of destiny, when we're no longer concerned about moral code, when we don't care what our children are doing, when we don't care that what we're doing, the decisions we're making are affecting our children, are affecting their decisions. We don't care that the fact that we sit home and watch TV on Sunday morning instead of coming to church, that shows your children that TV is more important than church, that church really isn't all that big of a deal, that church really doesn't matter. And in their own lives, those are the values that they adopt. Yeah. So let's talk about getting back your self-respect, because I painted a pretty glum picture. But it is possible tonight to get your self-respect back. Revelation 3:18 gives us the answer. Jesus Christ himself is speaking. He says, "I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire," talking about faith in God, "that you may be rich, and white garments," that's talking about righteousness, the righteousness of the Lord, "that you may be clothed," that we are to be souls clothed in righteousness, "that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed." What is the shame of our nakedness? Is the picture of sin exposing us for the vile creatures we truly are without God. That's what that means. That's the picture we're painting here. "So that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, we put on white garments," or garments or clothes, "of robes of righteousness. We anoint our eyes with eye salve, that the scales may fall off, that we can see as God sees, that we can see the state of our sin as it really is, that we can see the things that we're doing to our family, that we can see the things that we disregarded, that we can see the things we're about to lose." Investing in truth will bring real wealth with holiness, righteousness. It brings peace of mind. It brings a healthy, godly lifestyle. Respect and dignity automatically comes back with a godly lifestyle, with a lifestyle of purpose. We are people of dignity. With people of dignity, we care about things that we do. We care about the feelings of others. We care about what happens around us. We care about how our actions affect others. And respect is restored. Why? Because we have a godly covering. The real and spiritual effects of nakedness being covered up with robes of righteousness is number one, protection from the Lord. When we clothe ourselves in the righteousness of God, when we clothe ourselves in the moral code of God, when we clothe ourselves in the will of God, when we clothe ourselves in the destiny of the Lord, when we clothe ourselves in compassion and consecrate our hearts and our lives to the Lord, when we clothe ourselves in a desire to serve Him, to love Him, amen, to honor Him, to praise Him, and to worship Him, when we clothe ourselves in the priority of the Lord, then we are protected by the same Lord that we honor. We are blessed beyond belief. Dignity is restored. We become surrounded by loved ones, family, and loyalty, and friendships, because with dignity comes respect from people around you. Amen. With dignity, with respect, with righteousness, holding a standard. Amen. By being stable, these things all begin to gather around us. Those that had run for the hills when we started acting out. Come on, are you hearing me? Amen. Yes. We're talking about not forgetting your history. We're talking about stop rewriting who you think you were and start realizing that without Jesus Christ, you are that. This old man will not really die until we are given glorified bodies in heaven. So he is always there. He's always underneath. You know what protects you from the old man? You know what protects you from the old man? The new man in the clothing of righteousness. The clothing of righteousness, covering the blood of Jesus, covering the nakedness, the miserableness, pitifulness. Ezekiel 16, heard the story of the baby laying in a ditch, polluted in its own blood. Nobody even cut the cord. They just ripped it out of the mud, threw the baby in a ditch, weeds. It's polluted in its own blood. God walks by. God passes by and sees the baby. Picks her up, cuts her cord, cleans her up, washes her hair, buys her clothing, puts her in his home, raises her to do right, to make right decisions, buys her jewels, makeup, makes her gorgeous, buys her a prom dress, buys her a wedding dress, whatever, buys her, clothes her. And this is a spiritual application. Clothes her in utter beauty. And she is drop dead dynamic gorgeous. This is somebody that started out in a ditch polluted in her own blood. Now is the envy of the city. And she takes, read Ezekiel 16, it'll break your heart. She takes the beauty that God gave her and the blessing that God raised her in and the absolute saving of her life that she wouldn't even have any of this if it weren't for him. She'd be dead in a ditch, but no, she takes all of that God did for her and she becomes a prostitute because now she's gorgeous, she's worth money, and she prostitutes herself to the world. That's what she does with the gifts of God. Some of you have done that. You have taken everything God is, everything God made you, everything God gave you, everything God desired for you to have out of the blessing of his own marvelous heart. And you used all of it and threw it up in the air and became a prostitute to the world and said, look, world, have me. I don't care what God did. Investing in truth. Most of all, anoint our eyes with eye ointment, with eye salve, and you will be able to see. You will see clearly the meaning of life. You will see for the first time, perhaps, how you have despised your destiny and not considered God in calculating your life and your future. This investment alone will set your path again for a wonderful future. This investment in God, in buying the gold, doesn't perish, will set our future. I want to close with this thought, opening the door to the truth about yourself. Revelation 3:19 through 21. As many as I loved, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and I will dine with him and he with me. We use that scripture all the time in altar calls for sinners, but it was actually written to a church that has lost its way. It's actually written to a church that was miserable but thought they had need of nothing. There are people in here miserable that think you have need of nothing. I stand at the door and knock. Anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and I will dine with him and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne. If you overcome, Jesus invites you to sit with him on his throne to the right hand of the Father. You with him, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. What is the truth about me? What is the truth about me? Ask yourself that question tonight. What is the truth about me? What am I really capable of? What am I without Jesus? Well, the scripture tells us, we can all quote this together, I'm depraved, wretched, naked, poor, without Jesus Christ, and no matter how talented, slick, or lucky I am, I will never be anything better than what Christ can make me. Never. I could never miss out on a world that's depraved, that's miserable, that's wretched, that's pitiful, that's polluted in its own blood. Oh, why would you leave God to go to a world that's naked and miserable and laying in a ditch polluted in its own blood? But somehow that has something better than church services and serving God and lifting up your hands in worship. God has made us the best version of ourselves we could ever be. That's the truth about yourself, that without him. And as Natalie, from our opening illustration, sadly, we'll find out. Even $3.7 million is not worth what she has brought on herself by selling her virginity. God has made women different than that. And things like this cannot just be cast off without a price. And she should not be counseling families if she doesn't understand that little tidbit of truth. But Christ tonight is knocking. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and I will dine with him and he with me. The truth of this scripture, church, is that Christ is knocking on your heart only because you do have need of him. Listen to me. If Christ is knocking, it's not so you can say, hey, what's up? It's not to give you an option. He's knocking because you do have need. If there's conviction and the Holy Ghost is tapping you during a preaching, during an altar call, oh, it is not by accident. It is not for you to disregard. It's not for you to speak away. It's not for you to excuse away. It is so that you will answer the altar call, because I promise you, he doesn't knock unless he already knows you have need of him. You will only hear him knock if you will admit the truth about yourself. If you'll respect him enough to invite him in. The truth about yourself is that you are lacking everything without him. And so every decision you make is lacking. Every step you take is lacking. Every perception of you that you make of life is lacking. And so you will think you are rich. You think you got it going on. You think you're happening, when in fact you don't. In fact, as you will eventually discover, you are miserable, poor, and naked without Christ. But if you hear him tonight, if you would just hear him knock tonight on your heart's door, if you will open up that door, if you will let him in, because he brings you salvation, love, peace, and hope for your future, you can gain back your dignity, respect, value, validity as a human being. Amen. Then there's a promise for restoration. There's a promise that this can all turn around. There's a promise that God can make this better. There's a promise, amen, that if you will do that, amen, you will no longer be pitiful. You will no longer be miserable, blind, or naked. You will no longer be any of those things. There is a promise for restoration tonight. Oh, God longs to restore. God is married to the backslider. God desires above all else to restore the heart. Amen. God wants you so badly to be with him. God loves you and draws you near, and he draws you near with all the power of the universe because he loves you that much. Revelation 3:21, to him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne. You'll watch this. Do you see this? That's a picture of him gathering you out of your pollution to himself, to his throne, to his heart, to your future, to your destiny, to your dignity, to your respect. That's where you belong. Let's bow our heads. Jesus loves you. You're not saved tonight. I hope you listen. I hope you paid attention. Because as I was putting this together today, I had no idea who would be here tonight. No idea how many we would have. I was hoping for 400, but we fell short. But I do know this, God knew exactly who would be here tonight. God knew exactly who we are, what we're capable of, where we've been, where he's brought us. I've prayed with one time or another with probably everybody in here. Most of you, I prayed the sinner's prayer with. Howbeit, not all of you. You're not saved if you're not right with God tonight as you're not. You lift up your hand and ask to pray for me. I want to get my heart right. You're backslidden. You're not right with God. He's knocking at your heart's door. He's knocking because you do have need. One of the most popular terms in this generation is you say something to somebody, say, no, I'm good. I'm good. I'm good. That's equates to I have need of nothing. I'm good. I'm fine. It's the way I am. I'm fine. I've given somebody a flyer that put up their hands without taking it, and they'll say, I'm good. They've said it more than once. The fact of the matter is they're not good. They're not right. They're not okay. They're not in need of nothing. They need everything. But they put up their hands. They won't even take the piece of paper and read it later. They'll literally put up their hands and refuse to take a flyer from me and say the words, I'm good. Natalie said, there's nothing wrong with what I'm doing. I'm 3.7 million. Will really set the career on a path. All it is my virginity. All it is representative of the entire purity and worth of my life. Here we are, capable of so much for God. Capable at the same time of so little in the world. One of my favorite sayings to people that don't get a clue is one day you're going to wake up 65, miserable, and figure out your life is at its last sunset and you have nothing and nobody. You spent your whole life disappointing people. I've said that before to a homeless man who had grandchildren somewhere, didn't know where. Sitting on the steps in front of Golden Corral in Tucson, Arizona. I told him, one day you're going to wake up. Of course, he was already 70. I said, one day you're going to wake up. Your life is going to be over. You're going to realize you have nothing. And you've lived your life. You should be somebody's apartment, somebody's house somewhere. With your daughters, your sons, grandchildren bouncing on your knee, playing in the other room, dinner cooking on the stove. But because of drugs, because of partying, because of selfishness, because of all that you wanted for you, you've lost out on an entire lifetime. Next stop is eternity. You're not saved, you're not born again, you're backslidden. You'd like to get your heart right, you lift up your hand quickly. All over this place, Pastor, pray for me. Anybody? Amen. Let's all present. Come and find a place to pray. Hallelujah.